It's a pleasure to welcome you to this podcast, which focuses on the transformational power of ecosystems and the impact on long-term value creation. I'm Greg Fox, and I'm an alliance and ecosystem innovator. I will be moderating this session, and as firms seek new sources of growth, an increasing number are participating in and are orchestrating ecosystems where two or more entities seek to create more value together than they could on their own. And now, as a top CEO imperative meant to enhance company performance and accelerate innovation, companies are experimenting and finding success across a variety of ecosystem models. Greg Sarafin from EY and Will Yaffe from Tidwit, two ecosystem industry giants, in my opinion, have come together to discuss and answer questions centered on a shared vision on the transformative power of dynamic ecosystems built on a modern architecture that includes technology, data, and relationships, and which allows for speed, flexibility, scale, and resulting mutual value creation. So let me take the opportunity to introduce Greg and Will, respectively, and then we'll dive right into some key questions. As a principal at EY and the Global Alliance and Ecosystem Leader, Greg Sarafin oversees the continuous evolution of EY's strategy of selecting, engaging with, and creating value from EY's ecosystem partners. He manages a global EY team that provides the core enablement for such relationships, including business development, relationship management, financial management, and reporting. He also has direct oversight for three of EY's largest global alliance relationships, and that includes IBM, Microsoft, and SAP. He joined EY in 2015 as America's Financial Services Organization, Alliances and System Integration Leader, where he was responsible for a large team of technology implementation professionals supporting EY's business transformation solutions in the US and multiple delivery centers globally. Greg has published articles on a variety of technology topics and earned a Bachelor of Science in Computer Science and Engineering from the University of Pennsylvania. And outside of the office, interestingly, he's an unabashed binge watcher. We're going to learn a little bit more about that in the Q&A. An avid traveler, fervent foodie, and a devoted father of three. Will Yaffe is the founder of Tidwit. Together with an awesome team, Will has built a cutting-edge cloud ecosystems network that empowers the digital transformation of global organizations. Will has been honored to see the Tidwit cloud ecosystem network serve great customers such as Microsoft, IBM, Accenture, Dell, HPE, and Vodafone, and many others. And he enjoys balancing work with community activities focused on entrepreneurship, education, and ICT. In his free time, Will enjoys reading books on topics ranging from ecosystems to economic development, public policy, education, artificial intelligence, robotics, and futurology. Will earned a bachelor's degree in finance and IT from George Washington University School of Business, an MBA in information technology and finance from George Mason University, and a master's of public administration in development economics and international development from the Harvard Kennedy School. So welcome, Will Yaffe, to our podcast.
It's an honor to be here and to be joined by Greg Sarafin as well. So thank you for having us.
Absolutely. Greg Sarafin, let's start with the basics of what an ecosystem is. How would you define an ecosystem and its associated attributes and characteristics?
Ecosystem, let's boil it down to the core principle, which is going back to the start of time, businesses have partnered together to create more value than they can create on their own. The first examples of that were, frankly, marketplaces, right? Where marketplace operators would bring vendors together in a single convenient shopping experience for customers, and everybody would benefit from that experience. The vendors would benefit, as would the operator, as would the shoppers. So these models have been around for a really long time, and they take different forms. Marketplaces, the technology world for five decades now, technology companies have been running, what they call partner ecosystems, where they'll have OEMs, ISVs, GSIs, and a whole other alphabet soup of acronyms that we won't bother to decode in this podcast. And you know, you go down the line, just about every industry, there are examples of how in that industry there's a prevalent partnering model. But what we're seeing today is the, I'll call it the supercharging of partnership models, because the technology barriers to interoperability that used to make it very hard to do really meaningful things together, and certainly to do them together quickly, have fundamentally pivoted towards unlocking new types of partnerships. And I think that's going to be a lot of what we talk about today is, you know, that intersection of how technology is enabling these partnering models, just as these partnering models are getting bigger, more complex, and more important, and creating more complex types of value that is ultimately consumed by a common set of customers. The reason we call it ecosystem is because, you know, it, at the end of the day, these are, you know, different participants, all of whom are in a system together, working together for a common good. So kind of the definition of ecosystem. Although, because, you know, I don't want ecosystem to end up like digital, we actually, as you know, we actually call it ecosystem business models. We've defined seven, I'll call them archetypes, or, you know, repeatable patterns of these business models that we've written about. And indeed, you know, in my role at my company, I look at any value creation opportunity through the lens first of, okay, well, what kind of partnering model should we be thinking about? Because each model has its own sort of pros and cons, pluses and minuses for a particular type of outcome you're trying to achieve in the market. So that's what we mean by ecosystem and ecosystem business models. It's just a more structured way of thinking about what we've been doing for thousands of years in business. And it's a recognition now that it's become a bigger and bigger part of what all of us do at our companies and what our companies do, because the market's demanding it. The ultimate expectation of customers, both in terms of the type of value you deliver them and the speed at which you deliver innovation and value to them, is well beyond the means of just any one company to do themselves. And so I think that's why you're seeing this acceleration.
Will, you have recently shared insights in your work at Tidwit and contrast what you call a dynamic versus a static enablement ecosystem. Can you talk a little bit about what are the differences between a static and dynamic enablement ecosystem? Why is one more valuable than the other?
Well, I think to a certain degree, both are valuable. And static ecosystems, really, you can look at it more like a time frame, right? The static ecosystems kind of started, I guess, in the past, maybe 6-7 decades, when organizations kind of were trying to see how they can organize either their production or their downstream selling. And for the most part, they were static because you could kind of fix more or less what you wanted. Products took a long time to develop and you know, produce and then launch. So product life cycles, things like that, the world was a bit slower back then. And so the static nature of ecosystems, some of them would call them channels at the time, if you're looking at the downstream motion, or, you know, some of the just in time, you know, upstream motions where you had providers filling your stuff in and just in time, kind of the Japanese model, et cetera. So all that kind of stuff was fairly static. Now, when I say static, I don't mean it in any negative connotation. I just meant that it didn't change all that much. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you kind of get, I guess, you know, fast forward now to the 70s, 80s, the IT industry started learning a lot from a lot of what was happening in industry, particularly the car industries, electronics, et cetera. And they kind of went with that static model with channels. And all these guys did extremely well. So I wouldn't say one necessarily didn't provide any value. Now, what's happening with the dynamic ecosystem model, I think Greg just alluded to some of that, is that as, you know, the IT revolution started happening, things started speeding up. So in place of having a 5 to 10 year kind of product cycle, all of a sudden you had a, you know, 2 to 3 product life cycle, and then, or, you know, kind of your product launch cycle, right? And then all of a sudden that went down into months. And now fast forward to what we're seeing now, it's down to weeks. And it's almost in real time. And so the cloud, now you just launch products, improve products, and really there isn't all this infrastructure required anymore that you needed to have in the 70s and 80s. that change in business has been causing a huge amount of change in how you actually interact with your partners, be they upstream providers of yours or be they the downstream. So this whole sea change, you know, some people will classify it under digital transformation, has caused there kind of to be a rift with the traditional static tools that were designed to support the static channels. They don't, you know, act as well within a dynamic nature. And so when I differentiate between static ecosystems and dynamic ecosystems, and that was the probably you were referring to the one of the latest blogs I wrote, my point in highlighting this is if your organization is trying to jump on the dynamic ecosystem side of things, and not all organizations will, but a lot of the IT companies and SaaS companies, et cetera, are, then you have to realize that. Because if you try to do that, but try to do use tools that are static in nature, you're going to fail. Your idea is right. Your vision is right. Your strategy could be right, but your implementation is going to fail. And that's what we're seeing. So increasingly, organizations need to understand that the tools that they need to be using to deploy dynamic ecosystems are going to be different from what they used to deploy in the static. And I'll say one last thing here. A nice analogy when I usually sit down with customers to explain this is think about, you know, virtual computing environments, you know, kind of digitally transforming your organization. Think about if you had that vision, that strategy, and you wanted to deploy that, but then you went and basically asked your IT department to deploy a 1990s LAN computing environment. Right, it's only going to get you that far. It's not going to get you far at all. You're not going to have a virtual, you know, dynamic virtual environment that your digital transformation is going to, you know, is trying to accomplish. And so, to me, and I'll end with this: digital transformation for me that's been happening, which is revolutionary in the past decade. The next frontier of this digital transformation is going to be the expansion into the dynamic ecosystem, where you take all of this virtual environment, this extremely dynamic environment of IT, very powerful, and you don't limit it to within your proverbial walls, but now you actually take it outside to your ecosystem. And we can talk a little bit more about that later.
Greg, through your client interactions and research, I know EY has observed and identified and utilized 7 distinct ecosystem business models. You referred to that in your kind of opening definition of what an ecosystem is. Each of those have a unique and distinct go-to-market, risk sharing, and commercial characteristics. How does a company determine which type of ecosystem business model to apply? Any thoughts on that?
First, let me just say that, you know, the reason we came up with 7 models was because we went through an exercise to say, hey, look, we don't want to have every relationship be bespoke and try to operate it because that's just not scalable. Nor do we want to have a one-size-fits-all model that we try to force every relationship into. So we stepped back and said, okay, where are repeatable patterns? And we looked at things like governance, risk sharing, value sharing, go-to-market structure, co-innovation mechanism, and so forth to say, where can we sort of draw the line? It's not one, but it's not infinite. It's somewhere in between that. And so when we sit down, put pen to paper, and whiteboarded it out, it turned out we found 7 that we could look at and say, okay, those happen. We can see them not only at EY, we can see them outside of EY in multiple instances, right? So we can point to them and say, yep, they exist today. We're not just making them up. And we can also say that, yes, these characteristics are remarkably common. They're not exactly the same. So, you know, even though we have these 7 models, each relationship starts with a model, but then still there's a little bit of customization for the specifics of that commercial arrangement between EY and the partner. You're never going to be completely cookie cutter in these things, but you try to have as much common infrastructure as possible to speed the rate at which both you can form these relationships as well as then the effectiveness with which you can prosecute value in the market together. So to your core question, you know, how do you determine which model to use and also whether you participate or you orchestrate, right? Because that's the other piece of this. You know, an ecosystem, there's at least one entity that orchestrates the others, right? That's sort of the leader of the band, if you will. And sometimes, you know, generally speaking, the orchestrator has a disproportionate benefit in the value flows through that ecosystem business model, right? You look at SAP, it's a, what is it, a $30 billion company with a $150 billion ecosystem, and the largest participant in their ecosystem does $8 billion. So SAP is the predominant beneficiary of the SAP ecosystem, and the same with Microsoft and so forth. So the model, though, becomes pretty apparent, right? When you look at the value, the end customer, you look at the most direct path to creating value for that customer, you look at who your potential partners are, and you look at the predominant models that, you know, would unlock a direct path to that customer with minimum friction, it's not hard to figure out which model actually makes the most sense. In fact, it's generally trivial to figure it out. Once you have the seven models, you go, oh yeah, that's a cooperative relationship. We should do that with emphasis because we're going to be able to benefit our, you know, this set of customers. And, you know, yeah, even though we have competitive overlap, we also have sufficient differentiation that when we pull it together, it's actually a higher value than, you know, if we go at it separately. So it becomes pretty quick once you have the menu to pick out which item on the menu actually is the meal that you want to eat in a particular business situation.
And Will, you talk about the newest trend in technology partner enablement and this idea of equalizing the ecosystem via a self-guided journey. What do you mean by that? And how does that translate into an increased ability to create, sell, and market joint solutions?
I love how Greg mentioned it, and you know, kind of like how he, you know, mentioned whether you're participating or whether you're orchestrating. To us, it's a continuum, and you could be both at the same time. At, you know, for example, you mentioned Greg was with IBM for a while, and I'm sure from his experience with IBM, IBM is, as he probably knows, is the largest patent producer in the United States. So they produce a lot of technology, but IBM is also one of the largest consumers of technology, or at least the resellers of technology through their GSI arms, et cetera. And so they have these kind of like duality to them. And a lot of organizations do that. So that's one element that's extremely important to how you architect ecosystem solutions. Are you going to be one side? Are you going to be both sides? Are they completely different divisions that are handling each part? So that kind of falls into the organizational thinking that Greg just mentioned. And I love the fact that they have a model. Now, to answer your question with respect to the ecosystem enablement piece. So for us, you know, my own kind of entrepreneurial history has been in enablement. So we're talking about everything from content management to learning to marketing to, you know, the entire, let's say, a partner journey to enable that partner to drive revenue, essentially. So that was kind of like my history, my entrepreneurial history. The ecosystem element of it really started when we started working with some of these large technology companies, the Microsoft and the IBMs, et cetera. And what we found is that there aren't any more any kind of point-to-point or peer-to-peer relationships. There are, but in reality, for every relationship that exists between, say, a Microsoft and an IBM, IBM has dozens, if not hundreds, with other organizations. And Microsoft has, you know, dozens, hundreds, and thousands with other organizations. So it's a huge jungle of relationships that exist. And when you're going to invest in a relationship to kind of connect your ecosystem with another organization's ecosystem somehow, say you're a SaaS provider and you want to enable the GSI arm of IBM to kind of resell you. Well, guess what? All of a sudden, now you're plugged not only into IBM, but IBM's internals. You could be plugged into IBM's downstream channels, maybe corporate customers, maybe who knows? So it's kind of like an ecosystem to ecosystem. So how is the best structure that kind of drives this? And that's how we kind of landed on the notion that, you know, enablement and ecosystems have to be able to talk to one another. They need to be architected from the ground up. Traditional enablement solutions don't have that flexibility from the ground up to provide, for example, nodal connectivity, where if I'm connecting to Microsoft, I also want to connect to SAP, and I want to connect to Adobe, and I want to connect to Oracle, as one example. But I don't want to have four huge integration projects because that's not my job. My job is basically to deliver technology down to the market. So I want to make it really kind of like a snap, like a plug and play. And those kinds of things, when we looked at ecosystems, are missing. And so this level of standardization, this level of kind of nodal element of ecosystems, this democratization process, we found that missing. And that's kind of been the crust of the efforts that we've been doing within TIGWIT. One thing I will mention here is we increasingly see that the market, even the largest players, I mean, I know a lot of people look at ecosystems like Microsoft and Apple, and those are anomalies, right? I mean, those are massive behemoths of ecosystems. Not every organization in the world has that or can ever have that, right? And so we can't look at the 0.0001 and tell everybody, okay, do that, right? Because they're never going to be able to do that, or odds are against it. But what we can do is, listen, there's 99.9% of the companies want to be able to have connectivity together. And so there's this level of democratization, I think, is a very important element of both enablement and ecosystems coming together. And the fact that we are able to drive state-of-the-art technology that delivers on things like nodal, flexible, standardized, dealing with thorny issues that Greg alluded to, such as, for example, compliance. I don't want to send my people's PII over to your organization. I want to kind of hide them behind my own, but I still am willing to share some aggregate information with you, those kinds of stuff. Also providing unprecedented visibility, all that kind of stuff really ends up being the result if we can break down this new paradigm into tools that could be delivered to ecosystem practitioners, dynamic ecosystem practitioners going forward.
Greg, you talk about how EY is now a platform company and that EY is involved in the curation of ecosystem participants. Can you share an example or two of the central role that EY is playing in that particular effort?
To Will's point about it's a journey, right? So when you look at EY's journey in creating value through partnerships, through ecosystem business models, as if we've now sort of tagged them, primarily they were working with the tech giants as a participant in their symbiotic ecosystem model. And what we wanted to do as we evolved and matured was to both diversify the types of models we worked in and also become an orchestrator ourselves, right? Going back to that idea that, yes, you can live in both, EY lives simultaneously in multiple ecosystem business models. Many of them are participant, but increasingly we're orchestrators in some of them, right? And so that's been part of the journey. The one that, I think most of us can identify with, many people listening probably drive a car or know somebody who drives a car and they have, automobile insurance, which, everybody loves that product, right? Oh God, here in 6 months, I have to pay another outrageous amount of money just so I can drive once a week.
Yes.
So one of our clients came to us nationwide, which is a large insurance carrier in the US. And this is public information. So, and they basically challenged us to say, listen, you've been our partner with a company called Guidewire, which is a big software company in the insurance industry, for quite some time. You've done great work implementing core insurance business processes on the Guidewire platform, digitizing our business, right? Our core business. But we've reached a place in the maturity of the market in the US in particular, where that next generation of buyers, my kids, millennials and Zs, I guess they are, they're not gonna drive very much. And they're not going to really be up for buying a 6-month premium policy based on their prior driving history. Mm-hmm. They want something that's digital. They want to pay when they're driving and not when they're not driving. Mm-hmm. And they want to pay a fair amount of money based on the risk that they're experiencing at the time they're driving, not on some underwriter's expectation of their risk in the future. That's a huge difference between what these companies are doing today, right? Yes. And so the challenge we received is, hey, go out there and figure out how to do this for, enable us to do this in a very short period of time and in a very cost-effective manner, which is a fair ask for many clients. So our insurance team, which is phenomenal, David Connolly leads this group. They did something incredibly innovative. They said, all right, we're gonna stitch together all the elements. There's all these startups out there that have been funded with private capital. And each one of them has a little piece of being able to offer this solution to millennial and Gen Z buyers, right? It's called Pay As You Drive. But none of them has the full picture, and none of them is really big enough to effectively work with a huge company like Nationwide. They're not designed to be a supplier. They were designed actually to be a disruptor. So our insurance team said, all right, well, let's stitch them together on this platform. So we built this platform on Microsoft, right? Built an API layer. They plug in the API, and that layer creates the full set of services that you need to enable pay-as-you-drive product if you're a Nationwide. And, you know, we're really proud of that team. Using that model, first of all, you talk about capital efficiency, right? We use my favorite phrase is, I love to use the capital of others, right? We use the capital of others, and we aggregated it together in a way that it was worth more, right? Than it was individually in the market. And we were able to, in a year, get Nationwide into a pilot, and then shortly after that into production. So, and now we take that to other clients as well. And it's this really cool thing now, because we've got the platform, and then, you know, client B will say, well, yeah, I like those, but I like these over here. Can you plug these in? Right. And so now we've got this situation where we're orchestrating this dynamic, I guess to use Will's word, right? Dynamic ecosystem. It's like a client says, I like A, B, and C. You don't have D. Go get me D. Plug it in, right? And we're able to do that in a very quick way, weeks, right? To Will's point, because we've built this technology platform. And that really goes back to, you know, what Will is saying. When I opened up with, we call it the interoperability hurdles for business working together have really dropped to near zero, yeah. Right? Thanks to the public cloud, the API economy, platforms like Will is building to allow collaboration in a safe and effective manner, partner relationship management platforms fit for purpose for co-selling and co-marketing, co-innovating. These things, these technologies are now all coming together in a way that all of us can orchestrate when it makes sense to orchestrate, participate when it makes sense to participate, but come together and interoperate really, really quickly and effectively, and thus getting in that sort of dynamic vision that Will's been painting for us about where ecosystem is going to. And we completely agree with that. Ecosystem models are going to increasingly be dynamically coming together in a very short period of time to create value, because that's what capital markets demand, right? Capital markets want efficiency.
Yep.
And that's what we have to deliver.
Will, Tidwit is an emerging entrant into the fast-growing alliance and ecosystem enterprise software market. You've been recognized, you know, by Jay McBain, a lot of industry analysts, and you're helping kind of the world's largest ISVs and GSIs boost their operations by streamlining the process of delivering sales, technical, and marketing education and training to thousands of employees which need these resources to optimize partner offerings. Can you share an example or two of ecosystems that you've enabled by your software and some of the results that you've seen so far?
You bet. And I love from the example that Greg gave is that you're starting to see some of the traditional or even, you know, companies that are not necessarily startups kind of looking at their asset, right? They're looking at, I mean, one of the biggest assets that most organizations that you know, value their assets have is their, you know, partner organizations and their relationships and all that kind of stuff, which is usually hard, you know, it used to be hard to measure in the, you know, in the IT world. You kind of, I think they've done a good world, like the ID, they've done a good amount of work, the IDCs of this world, to kind of measure the downstream influence of reselling and all that kind of stuff. And it's usually, sometimes we see them, you know, anywhere ranging between a 5x and a 10x what the actual software provider might be selling. The downstream actually makes 5 to 10x that in added revenue and value adds, et cetera, et cetera. And so those kinds of scenarios, we're starting to see them not only with the smallest of the organizations that are trying to compete with the midsize and the large ones, we're starting to see them also with the larger ones. And, you know, such as the example that Greg gave with Nationwide. One of the examples that we like to usually cite, and we're very proud of it, really. I mean, I'm, as an immigrant myself, having come here and you know, work with technology and resold technology and all of that to get to a point where we're actually providing technology to organizations such as Microsoft and IBM is a really a big source of pride and, you know, for us. But really, it starts with the relationship between these two organizations that spans about 50 years and trying to find new ways to kind of, you know, scale what's happening or to meet the demand of what's going on. And so one of the scenarios there that you kind of were asking about is, you know, give us an example of what these types of organizations have been able to do. Well, you know, in the past, it used to be kind of like I want to use this term kind of a little bit freely, if you'll excuse me, jostling between the two organizations. You know, you send the people here, you're giving me MDF, I need to show you this, that, the other thing. But it wasn't really as tightly collaborative. And so one of the things that we were tasked with is, listen, we want to launch some global initiatives and we want to be able to scale them. Could you help us find ways that we can kind of connect the two ecosystems together? And you know, here we are kind of like little Tidwit back, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, just starting up. We had something that was called, you know, kind of like an ecosystem platform that was just at its inception. And what we did is we said, okay, but here's the basic premises you need to connect. Kind of we started more on a philosophical basis as opposed to just delving straight into the technology, which is, listen, each organization is going to continue doing what it's been doing. We are not going to go in and rip and replace anything. Each organization is going to be able to control its usership. Each organization is going to have, you know, ownership of its data. Each organization can customize and kind of, you know, feel ownership, right? The sense of ownership of this. Are you guys in agreement? And that was kind of how it started. And then from there, of course, we developed all the technology that connected those organizations. Here's some interesting metrics that we kind of found that also shocked us, which is when we started talking to them, it's like, you know, what size of community do you think engages between both organizations? And the answer at the time was probably somewhere in the range of about 8,000. Well, here we are, fast forward 3 years, and there's more than 100,000 people between both organizations engaged. I mean, that's a factor of 10 between two organizations. That's only two organizations. You could start seeing the effects of once you let people, you empower people to kind of do the things that they know how to do in the way that they do it. You're just empowering them with knowledge. The scale up becomes massive. And that was a big eye opener for us. So those are the kind of things that we've been seeing. And increasingly, we're seeing it kind of coming down in size. So it's no longer limited to the largest. Now we're seeing it at the mid-size because they want to be able to also kind of get in on the act. And the SMBs that never had those systems that they needed to jostle with anyway, they're just looking for, okay, how can I really connect very, you know, dynamically, quickly? How can I be agnostic to everybody? How can I make my stuff available and get stuff that's available out to me? So that's been really the evolution of what we've been seeing with ecosystem enablement. And this was one example that we're really very proud of.
Greg and Will, let me just kind of open this up to each of you, just if you want to respond. As you think of firms, which kind of firms come to mind on those that are doing ecosystems well or right? What would you say some of their attributes are? You know, how have they become successful? Any top of mind firms that you can think of that you think are doing ecosystems well in the industry?
I think there are certain industries where a number of the participants have really gotten very good at ecosystem. Certainly the technology and telecoms industries have been doing it for decades and have a fairly mature partner ecosystem model. Not to say there's not room for improvement. There always is, they're pretty effective at creating surface area and value realization ultimately for the end customer. Mm-hmm. So, but what's interesting to me, Greg, is we're going to see a whole new cadre of enterprises and industries who are pivoting their business models and all of a sudden will go from being, for example, a product company mm-hmm. to being a company that sells outcomes with a superior experience. So for example, the automotive industry, right? They're going from selling cars to selling mobility experiences.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right. and including this whole concept of, hey, you don't have one car anymore. You have different types of vehicles at your disposal when you want to use them. You only pay for them when you use them. You only pay the insurance when you use it, to go back to our previous example, right? And by the way, everything's built in, right? You don't have to, you have to do separate maintenance. You have to do separate insurance. You have to do separate fueling it. Like, it's all taken care of for you. So, you know, that is a huge, and it's not just automotive, right? If you look at any industry, you know, shoot, the athletic shoes, Nike, what's Nike becoming? It's becoming a lifestyle company, an activity-based lifestyle company, tied back to high performance athletes is sort of the halo, but ultimately Nike's creating a very intimate relationship with its customers through something that's important to them, which is their health and their well-being. And so again, that's just multiple examples of that. Well, you know, those companies all are having to become digital citizens. They're having to have a digital engagement model, a platform, to engage with their customers in a new way. And so they're becoming platform companies, not just product companies. And as we know, platform companies, in order to ultimately achieve their ultimate outcomes, have got to effectively build ecosystem around them to achieve the value realization for the end customers. So to me, the fascinating thing is to look at industry after industry, energy industry. Who would have thought they need to become green? They need to help greenify the world, right? So they're now building business units whose job it is to help cities and regions do infrastructure projects to reduce increase renewable and reduce energy waste. Well, that requires an ecosystem. So they need to become masters of the operating ecosystems. Yeah. And to Will's point, now you're gonna have all these companies are gonna be coming into these models where they're just gonna have to get really, really good at collaborating. And then I'll just layer one more thing on top of it and then flip it over to Will. ESG, sustainability, right? Scope 1, 2, and 3. You no longer get to say, I get to ignore what my supply chain put into the things that I ultimately assemble and pass down my value chain. And also I have to care about how my end customer uses and disposes of whatever I sold them. Well, okay, now we've created just a business regulatory environment that forces a higher level of collaboration, data flow, data sharing, et cetera, in a world that's also complicated by data privacy and other complications. And so if you just look at it, Greg, you can just see in industry after industry, they're having to pivot. They're having to become digital natives. They're having to have ecosystem business models, whether they like it or not, whether they're good at it or not. The ones that consistently, in our view, succeed are the ones that already have a culture of collaboration.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Internally, they know how to, they're led, they have a collaborative mindset versus a transactional mindset or worse, you know, sort of just an ultra competitive mindset. It's like, we come together, we embrace diversity, equity, and inclusion. We embrace working together internally and with our partners. If you've got that core bedrock culture in your organization, then your likelihood of success going external and collaborating to create value is much, much higher,
yep,
in our experience than, you know, if you don't. And I think that's an important thing for companies to look at as they're, you know, moving into this space more and more. We're also transforming.
Yeah.
Right. Because our industry is changing too, right? The old 100% of your billing is rate times hour plus expenses. That model is no longer the model of our industry. Increasingly, our industry, we're getting encouraged and sometimes have to risk share and get paid for outcomes versus hours, yep, and effort, right? Yep. And increasingly the services we deliver have got to be underpinned by technology,
mm-hmm,
right? Whether it's data and analytics, it's bots doing certain things that the bots are just better at doing it than humans and more cost effective. All of that is true of us as well, right? Ultimately, we go from being a provider of advice, and implementation to being a provider of outcomes with a superior experience?
Yeah, there's a couple of success stories, one of which literally saved mankind over the past couple of years, and it's the pharma. I had the the honor of actually participating in a roundtable with some pharma companies, some of the largest in the world, and what I learned was fascinating. They're very competitive in regular life under normal circumstances, and of course there's a lot of IP that's protected and all that kind of stuff, and they do have ecosystems and very rigid types that they've had for close to a century with subcontracting contracts and all that kind of stuff. I mean, it had all been there. Now all of a sudden, fast forward to 2020, and now they're faced with a global crisis that they needed to overcome with a very limited time frame, and they needed, or they were forced, because of the market, but also through governmental initiatives, to collaborate with one another. So all of a sudden, you have a forced ecosystem model that they had never tried before. And what is fascinating is the collaborative nature that they fell back on, and how they collaborated together in a dynamic ecosystem, I would say, because it was, quote unquote, spun up only for that purpose, right? They still had their agreements and all that kind of stuff, very rigid. But when it came time to the crisis, they spun up this dynamic ecosystem between some of them to either do some R&D or production or scale up massive production, all that kind of stuff. Like a Merck would say, hey, I don't have, for example, the IP, but I do have these massive production facilities. Let's collab. That kind of collaboration happened, right? And it worked. And what is fascinating in talking to them is how they also were surprised at how it worked. And they were surprised about that cultural change that happened, which Greg just alluded to, in a very, very quick time frame. So I would say that is certainly one. The other, I would say, is interesting because it's coming from some of the younger generations that don't have as much experience with channels like some of us white-haired guys do. They basically are coming. It's not you, right? So they're coming from a world that essentially they were born into a very flat world, which is the internet, right? They were born into the Amazons and the Facebooks. It's a system and a user. They weren't really born into a world that was very hierarchical, multi-tiers and all that kind of stuff. But now they're having to face that. And what I'm seeing is there's a lot of innovation coming with them, interestingly enough, very willing to accept interchange of information with other, kind of alliance roles and other partners, et cetera, in ways that, older generations were not or are not willing to do. So they've brought that from that world. And the type of applications within ecosystems that I'm seeing that in, for example, within IT SaaS, you're seeing a lot of contact exchange. So you see tools out there from some of our partners like Crossbeam and those kinds of partners that allow organizations to kind of exchange contacts with one another, and enablement, where now they're kind of saying, you know what? I can exchange contacts with your organization, my organization, so that we can collaborate on leads and all that kind of stuff. How about if we start empowering each other with enablement or with marketing initiatives or co-sells, et cetera? So I'm also seeing those kinds of smaller to mid-sized SaaS organizations also doing a really, really good job on moving into this dynamic ecosystem space. So those are two success stories I would really highlight, together with some of the GSIs that I mentioned before.
Any parting advice that any of you would have for how firms might begin to activate, the transformational value and power of ecosystems and their impact on long-term value creation? Any kind of parting thoughts on how firms might do that?
I would say three things to anybody contemplating increasing the relevance of ecosystem to the value they deliver, because pretty much every company, whether they realize it or not, has some form of partnering going on, right? The first is put control points into your capital allocation investment decisioning processes to make sure that you are considering ecosystem business models much more rigorously when, you know, or not just defaulting to build and buy decisions, right? Build, buy, or partner. The partner's got to be an increasing percentage of how you think about your capital allocation, because it's going to increase your capital efficiency if you do it well.
Yep.
The second is the people that are your business strategy, you know, whoever in your organization collectively responsible for business strategy, you need to challenge yourself to say, look, we shouldn't just be thinking anymore about, you know, us statically, going back to Will's idea about that dynamic, statically in a value chain. When we think about our business strategy, how should we be either re-engineering our value chain and or our position in that value chain to capture more of the value that ultimately the end client receives and therefore that we receive and by contrast create? So your business strategy's got to go out of the traditional, okay, well, we can get this much more if we enter this market or that much more than that. You've got to start thinking more about how do we re-engineer the market, not which market do we enter.
Yep.
So, and with an ecosystem mindset.
Yep.
And then the third is, do not underestimate how difficult this is to actually execute. You need to put together a well-funded and well-staffed organization, people that are professionals that know how to build the enablement, go-to-market, governance, risk management, commercial constructs, all that stuff. It is critical to get that right, or you will dilute your capital, not enhance it, right? That's the other, the third piece is you really got to bring the people that know what they're doing in. You really got to make this a core discipline of your organization. It's got to be part of your organization's operating model. You think of it this way. You need to become an organization whose operating model can plug into other operating models really efficiently. So again, going back to Will's point about dynamic, yep, that dynamicism not only comes from technology, it also comes from your operating model. So those would be the three pieces of counsel I would give to anybody.
Add to Greg's point of empowering people, I think one thing that we have seen, and I'll end with this, is that sometimes we've seen that, you know, there is good intention at the highest level to really do what Greg just suggested, which is, you know, a launch an ecosystem model. But then they kind of put out this role of chief ecosystem officer or whatever, and they don't really empower them to deploy cross-functional area coordination. So you still have moats, which essentially would kill that connectivity that Greg is talking about. So on enablement, which is an area that we talk to, you've got the partner teams that want to enable partners, and you've got the, you know, the content and learning and all those kinds of teams that are sitting there. And if they don't talk to each other well enough, then this guy is doing something and is being forced to deliver on some things that are not supported and vice versa. And so when you have these roles in place, you got to empower these folks. And so what I like to say to my customers is have your CEO, you know, have that E become not only executive, but also ecosystem. Have the CEO really take on an ecosystem kind of view, so that they become the chief ecosystem officer if they have a smaller chief ecosystem officer. But they really need to kind of, in some cases, it's going to drive so much value that those guys at the top need to make sure that everybody in the organization is up to the task. So I'll second what Greg said on that, 100%.
Well said, Will. We say, dude, we'll challenge the CEO, say, are you running a company or orchestrating an ecosystem?
Yep.
Right? Because, and you're right, it has to be the CEO. That's where it has to start. Because if it doesn't start there, it's never going to stick and become embedded in the fabric of how you operate the business.
One final, in the last minute that we have, one personal question to each of you as we kind of close things out. Greg, you mentioned you're an unabashed binge watcher. What are some of your favorite series that you've spent many hours watching in a single setting?
Recently, there's a couple Apple ones, Ted Lasso.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Isn't that great? And also there's this really cool one. What's it called? A futuristic one, which I'm blanking on right now. But I've watched all the other stuff that everybody watches. You know, Breaking Bad was one of my all-time favorites. I like Ozark, so I guess I'm a little dark. But there's some really good content out there. It's really enjoyable to binge watch it.
Awesome. Will, you've any recent memorable book that you've read and what you learned from it that you have enjoyed?
Yeah, actually, a couple. One was written by Malcolm Gladwell. It's called The Bomber Mafia, which is an awesome book. It's less known than some of his other books, but this is a book about this group of mavericks, you know, nutcases in technology and stuff, who were within the U.S. Army that came up with the crazy idea of, let's not bomb the heck out of people, let's precision bomb. It's a small thing, but very humanistic in its nature, because they didn't, you know, they wanted to kind of target things, and they were thought to be crazy and all. I don't want to ruin it, but if you have a chance, you know, Greg and Greg, to read this, it's a fascinating read. That's one. The other one I really like, and I haven't finished it yet. It's a book that's called Humankind, and it's written by a guy called Rutger Bergman. And essentially, it has a very simple hypothesis, which is people are basically good. And they're not good just, you know, humans, basically. We're not just good because we're, you know, we're just good. He justifies it, you know, in a pretty extensive book. But the bottom line is that if you collaborate, and if you're, you know, this is what helped us become or evolve much more than other humanoids and other species. It's our collaborative nature. And I guess that brings us back to the ecosystem notion, which is, if you collaborate and stuff like that, I think it's the way to go. It makes us a lot smarter, a lot faster, a lot more dynamic, and I think it drives a lot more value.